Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Purva Doke. I think we are meeting for the first time for such a kind of CME. And I hope that we have many more interactions in the near future with all of you all concerning the patients. So today's topic will be approach to the patient with an infectious disease from a general practitioner's perspective. So basically, we all know whenever a patient comes, the basic things that we do is the history taking, the general examination, and the systemic examination. Then we come to a differential diagnosis, we go on to the laboratory investigations if required in the patient, and the treatment which is done on the OPD basis. So when a patient is suspected to have any infectious disease, it is the usual history taking. But there will be a few points which we need to remember. First thing is fever. Fever more than 100 degree Fahrenheit or more than 38 degree Celsius. That when that is present in the patient, it will be considered as an infectious cause. Many patients come to us saying that they are just having a feverish feeling, or maybe they are having fever from the inside. That time we need to consider whether it is really a fever, whether there is really an infectious cause for the fever. So at such times, what we can do is just get a digital thermometer. It is absolutely cheap. Just ask the patients to buy one from the medical store. Digital thermometers directly with just after 1 minute, there's a beep and you come to know what is the temperature. So if it is more than 100 degree Fahrenheit, definitely we need to treat the fever. If it is less than that, if it is less than 38 degrees Celsius, there is no need to treat the fever because it will not be considered as a patient having temperature itself. Second thing is residence. If the patient is from Pune, definitely we have a lot of patients with dengue coming up. So that should be at the back of your mind. Secondly, if the patient says, I'm from Mumbai, come to Pune. Or let's say he has traveled to Mumbai recently for 1 or 2 weeks and then come back to Pune, then started with the fever. Then again, malaria should be at the back of the mind. Because in Pune, malaria cases are absolutely rare. In Mumbai side, Navi Mumbai side, we have a lot of malaria cases. P. vivax as well as P. falciparum, both cases are there. Now, many patients come from the outskirts of Pune, from Bhor Taluka, from Vela Taluka. In these regions, rickettsial fever is very common. That is endemic for rickettsial fever. So the residence becomes absolutely important in the history taking. Next is the localizing symptoms. Whatever the patient has, try to localize it to a particular system. I think that is the basic thing which we all of us do. If the patient has any URI symptoms, whether the lower respiratory tract is also involved, whether the patient has acute bronchitis, or whether he has pneumonia, or just acute rhinopharyngitis which is present. So that will help us to guide the laboratory tests also if required, and to guide whatever treatment is required. Similarly, whether the gut is involved, whether the gastrointestinal tract is involved, if the patient has a simple viral hepatitis, or if the patient has diarrhea, acute infective diarrhea, approach towards both the patients is different. Approach towards the laboratory investigations and the treatment is absolutely different for both the diseases. If the patient has a urinary tract obstruction, antibiotics will be entirely different than what you give for a respiratory system cause. So basically, we want to see what are the localizing symptoms which will help us to find out what is the differential diagnosis. Next is the comorbidities which are present, whether the patient is diabetic. Diabetic patients, they may not mount a fever response also as the immunity is suppressed. Whether the patients are any steroids, chronic steroid therapy, again, that becomes a very susceptible thing for pathogens. If the patient is a case of CKD, chronic kidney disease, on dialysis, again they come under the immunocompromised state. If the patient is HIV positive, etiology completely differs for the diseases which can occur in immunocompromised patients. History of travel, like I said before, if the patient has traveled to Mumbai, if the patient has traveled to Baramati, Vella side, Bor side, the approach, the differential diagnosis differs in such patients. Animal exposure. This point we really actually miss out in the history taking. Whether the patient is a farmer, he's been exposed to cattle, and he comes with a fever duration of 3 weeks, then brucella should be at the back of our mind. If the patient has any history of dogs, cattle, or cats in the house, pet animals also, then rabies becomes a possibility, toxoplasma becomes a possibility, cryptococcus also becomes a possibility when the patient is, you know, a bird lover, when he goes and feeds birds, when he feeds pigeons, that time cryptococcus also becomes a possibility. Previous surgeries become important. Many patients have renal calculi, they have undergone DJ stenting. And then when they come to us with a urinary tract infection, we need to find out whether any surgery for the renal calculi has been done previously, whether there's a DJ stent in situ. And now if the patient comes with UTI, that DJ stent could be a nidus of infection. We need to remove that. In such cases, more than the antibiotic, what is required? Removal of the DJ stent, removal of the foreign body which is present inside the patient is required. Of course, antibiotics will be given, but that also will be a treatment. Previous hospital admissions. If the patient comes to us with recurrent infection and he has got a history of previous hospitalization, important thing will be in the past 3 months, recurrent hospitalization in the past 3 months when he's been exposed to multiple antibiotics. Okay. So now when the patient comes to us, there is a more possibility of hospital acquired infections. Multi-drug resistant pathogens becomes the etiology in such cases. So the history of previous hospitalization is also important. Previous antibiotic use. If the patient has received any inadequate antibiotic, incorrect antibiotic, wrong duration of antibiotic he has received on the OPD basis, then if the patient comes to us, he may land up with having antibiotic resistance. Resistant pathogens may come up in the infections. And also the drug history becomes absolutely important. There is something called as drug fever, which is caused by the antibiotics itself. That doesn't require any more antibiotics. That just requires the stoppage of the antibiotic which is going on. So if it is drug fever, it will definitely go away within 24 to 48 hours. That is how we diagnose that, yes, this fever was because of the antibiotic. Once it goes away after stopping the antibiotic for 24 to 48 hours, we can definitely say it was because of the drug fever. And then the other drugs also, example phenytoin can also cause fever in some patients. Many psychiatric medications can also cause fever. So these fevers do not require any antibiotics. That is why the drug history becomes important. Examination, the general examination which we all of us do. But the important point which we usually miss out is the skin examination for eschar. Eschar, this is seen in rickettsial fever. This is a picture showing eschar. You can see that it is a cigarette mark, burnt out cigarette mark. That is how it is described. Usually seen in scrub typhus, which is common in India. Rickettsial fever in the endemic areas, Bor Taluka, that side, outskirts where it is seen. So always it is better in the simple clinical examination to expose the patient. These eschars are usually seen on the back, they are seen in the inguinal regions and on the lower extremities. So in the general examination, it is good to see for this eschar. And that helps us in the diagnosis. I'm not saying it will be present in almost every patient having rickettsial fever, but if it is present, it helps us in the diagnosis, it helps us in the treatment. So it should always be seen in the patient. Again, the systemic examination, we have to see for the localizing signs and try to localize which system is involved, which will help us in the further treatment. Try to have a differential diagnosis so that your treatment also differs according to that. If there is no localizing sign, many patients come to us with only fever and there is no localizing sign. In such patients, it is better to investigate, do the laboratory test, then to treat them with a lot of antibiotics, antivirals, antifungals. Because initially, without a differential diagnosis, if we treat the patients with antibiotics, then later on, the diagnosis may be masked because of the antibiotics that we may have given on the OPD basis. So it is always better to send the investigations. If the patient is hemodynamically stable, if he is coming to the OPD, giving an antibiotic is not an emergency. We can always wait, ask the patient to come back a second time, see if he is still febrile, see if the fever has reduced or not, and then follow up accordingly. There may be many non-infectious causes also of fever, like we already discussed. It could be drug induced, many drugs causing it. It could be a malignancy. It could be lymphoma. Even simple anemia, iron deficiency anemia, mild anemia. Patients do have a mild fever. but that does not require any antibiotics to be given. Once the anemia is corrected, definitely his fever, his feverish feeling will come down. So we need to actually find out whether there is an infectious cause behind the fever and then treat it with antibiotics, antifungals, antivirals, or whatever medicines are required for that. So this is the picture of Ishkar. Many patients come with this, so this should be looked after. So today's lecture, basically I'll be stressing on the tropical illnesses. We have a lot of patients coming with tropical illnesses. In the gastrointestinal tract, two main diseases, diarrhea and hepatitis. Urinary tract infection, a little about the respiratory system, and what are the labs that we need to do on the OPD basis, what is the treatment that we need to do on the OPD basis, a little bit about antibiotic resistance, and a little few points on the special population. So tropical illness, the main things which we find in Pune are dengue. Lot of patients still getting admitted, still coming to us with dengue, rickettsial fever, leptospirosis, malaria, and enteric fever. Malaria is put lower down because those patients are less in Pune. Enteric fever also commonly seen in Pune. We need to keep that at the back of our mind when we are thinking of a tropical illness in a patient. So now just a few differentiating points regarding the tropical illnesses. So one is dengue. A patient from Pune, dengue is endemic in Pune, we need to consider it as a diagnosis. Dengue divided into two, dengue with warning signs, dengue without warning signs. So a probable case of dengue becomes that patient who's got fever and who's got two of the other clinical features, like he may be having vomiting, he may be having a rash, a classic petechial rash which is present starting from the extremities. He may have some muscle aches, some myalgias may be present, headache may be present, classic which is described in the books, a retroorbital pain which is present. He may have leukopenia on the simple hemogram which we do. He may have a reduced platelet count. So these patients come under the probable case of dengue. On the OPD basis, this becomes a clinical diagnosis. So in the other patients, in a case of dengue, what we need to see are the warning signs if they are present. If the patient is having any encephalitis syndrome, if the patient is having convulsions, if the patient is having persistent vomiting, if the liver is palpable more than 2 centimeters, if the patient is having tender hepatomegaly, lot of muscle aches, if the hematocrit, we need to see that. And the platelet count, thrombocytopenia, if the patient is having any of these signs, it becomes a case of dengue with warning signs. And there is also a patient who will have severe dengue. In severe dengue, what is seen? One is severe hemorrhage. The patient may be bleeding mucosal sites from the mouth, from the urine. He may have epistaxis, bleeding from any site. He may have severe plasma leakage, which will be considered as dengue shock syndrome. Or maybe fluid accumulation in the lungs, leading to respiratory distress, lot of pleural effusion, lot of pulmonary edema, leading to respiratory distress. Again, that will be considered as severe dengue, and a lot of organ impairment also. The liver may be affected, the SGOT, SGPT levels may be high rising, skyrocketing. The other organs may be involved, the heart may be involved. Okay. So these patients are those who have got severe dengue. So we need to be careful when the patient has either warning signs or the patient has severe dengue. A simple case of dengue definitely can be managed on the OPD basis, while the other patients may require admission. So you need to be careful. Investigations to be sent is, I think all of us know, the dengue NS1, IgM and IgG. Many laboratories do the rapid test, which is a card test for dengue. That is not specific. What is required is the dengue, NS1, IgM or IgG if required by ELISA. Usually IgG, that just tells us that the patient had a past infection of dengue. When the patient comes to us on the OPD basis, we want to find out if the patient is actually having an acute infection with dengue. So all you need to send is the NS1 and the IgM. Usually the IgG is not required unless you want to find out whether the patient has a past infection. NS1, very highly specific. On day one itself, it will come positive. Okay? And it can remain positive for up to 7 days, 14 days. After 5 days of the acute infection, after 5 days of fever, IgM, the antibody titers, start rising. And they can remain high for up to 90 days. Okay. So if the patient comes with a history of fever for 1 day, if you're suspecting dengue, you can simply just send the NS1 test and nothing else. IgM and IgG also may not be required. If the patient comes with a fever of, let's say, 4 to 5 days and we are suspecting dengue, then we can definitely send the NS1 and the IgM. Usually IgG is not required, but the test should be done by ELISA and not by a rapid test. ELISA is confirmatory and not the rapid test. Treatment, we know for dengue, it could be with warning signs, it could be without warning signs, it could be severe dengue. It is supportive management only. No antibiotics required, no antifungals, no antivirals also required for dengue. It is absolutely supportive treatment. Give the patient lots of fluids according to the hematocrit. If the patient is having bleeding tendencies, what the WHO guidelines say, the World Health Organization guidelines say that whole blood should be transfused to the patient. There is no mention of platelet transfusion anywhere in the WHO guidelines. But what we follow is the platelet transfusion. I think outside and even in Bharati Hospital, that is what usually the doctors follow. The platelet transfusion, once the thrombocytopenia is seen, platelets are given. But the WHO guidelines say that whole blood should be transfused. Now next is rickettsial fever. Again, the residence becomes absolutely important. Patient may have very non-specific symptoms. He could be having headache, little fever, myalgias, muscle aches. Myalgias may be very much prominent in rickettsial diseases. Eschar, which will be there on the skin, may or may not be present. There could be a maculopapular rash on the extremities also. Again, the laboratory investigations that we need to send, besides the simple laboratory investigations of CBC, LFT and the RFT. In the CBC, what we'll see is that there may be a normal or reduced WBC count. It may be normal also. Platelet will be on the lower side. When we do the LFT, the SGOT and the SGPT levels will be raised. There will be transaminitis which is present. And many times the patient has hyponatremia also, okay, in patients of rickettsial fever. An important test that we do is the Weil-Fallot test, which is done on the OPD basis. We see the titers of the antigens, OX19, OX2 and the OXK. But this Weil-Fallot test is not at all specific, it is not at all sensitive also. What is more important, what is diagnostic, is the rickettsial PCR, which is not available. But we can rely on the Weil-Fallot test. If the eschar is present, if the Weil-Fallot is positive, definitely treat it as rickettsial fever. Give him doxycycline, 100 mg BD for 7 days. If it is definite rickettsial fever, the patient has to respond to 1 or 2 doses of doxycycline. Okay. It is unlikely if it is rickettsial fever and the patient is not responding to doxy. So that can also help us, you know, in the diagnosis. Yes, the patient had an eschar, the patient had a Weil-Fallot positive test and the patient responded to doxycycline. 100% it is rickettsial fever. Next is leptospirosis. Again, the occupation becomes important, whether he's a farmer, whether there are any rodents around, whether there was any urine exposure, you know, water exposure which contains the rodents, infected urine, contaminated water exposure. Such patients also will come with bleeding tendencies. They may have subconjunctival hemorrhage, classical. They may have jaundice, reduced urine output, and a lot of muscle tenderness. Muscle tenderness of the calves, muscle tenderness of the back. If that is present, if that is the prominent feature, more likely leptospirosis than the other diseases. But this is very non-specific. It may be present in dengue also, myalgias, but it is seen in many patients. The muscle tenderness is more prominent in leptospirosis. It may or may not be present. Again, the simple investigations which we do, the simple hemogram, that will again show leukocytosis. WBC on the higher side, platelet on the lower side. Okay, leukocytosis and thrombocytopenia. So jaundice is present, bilirubin may be on the higher side, the enzymes may be on the higher side, creatinine may be on the higher side. So in such patients, again, what we need to do is the PCR, but that is not available so easily. So the lepto IgM is done. Remember, it is a serological test. In the lepto IgM, what we see is the antibody, whether that is present or not. So in the acute infection, antibody response won't be there of the host. These antibodies will come up after 1 week. So on day one, if we do the lepto IgM, it will be negative because the antibody response has not yet come up. So when it is of significance, when the lepto IgM is sent after 7 days of illness, after 7 days of fever, myalgias, if we send the lepto IgM and it comes positive, we can definitely rely on that. So lepto IgM in the first week, do not give consideration to that. Treatment remains the same, doxycycline 100 mg BD. So we are covering both rickettsial fever as well as leptospirosis with doxycycline. Dengue, if that is there, it will require supportive treatment only. And malaria, if a patient gives a history of travel to Mumbai or the patient is a resident of Mumbai and come to Pune, then definitely we need to consider malaria. In malaria, always see if it is complicated malaria. If it is complicated malaria, it is better to admit the patient and treat. If it is a simple case of malaria, definitely you can go ahead with the OPD basis treatment. So important is the peripheral smear for malarial parasite on the fever spike. We will come to know whether it is P. vivax or P. falciparum, and the treatment differs accordingly. The RMT, the rapid malarial test, which is done. Now this RMT can remain positive for several weeks after the acute infection. So these two things we need to remember. For the diagnosis, for the confirmation of malaria, what is absolutely necessary is the peripheral smear showing a malarial parasite, maybe of vivax or falciparum. Rapid malarial test, if the patient may had an infection with malaria 1 week ago, and the second week again he comes with a fever history, the RMT will remain positive from the past infection itself. So again in the second week, what remains important for the confirmation of malaria will be the peripheral smear showing the parasite. Now typhoid, many patients come to us with that. The disease burden is very high in India. We have lots of people who eat outside food from the street side vendors, many college going students who eat outside food from the street side vendors, as it is absolutely cheap. But again, these places are very unhygienic. So there may be usually youngsters who come with us with a high grade fever, myalgias, abdominal pain, diarrhea, which is more common than constipation in typhoid fever. On examination, relative bradycardia may or may not be present. What is relative bradycardia? Usually, when the patient has fever, the pulse rate, when the temperature rises by 1 degree Celsius, the pulse rate also usually rises by, let's say approximately 10 beats per minute. But in relative bradycardia, that does not happen. So if that is there, we can always suspect typhoid. But it is a very non-specific sign, may also be present in the other diseases. The patient may have hepatosplenomegaly, tenderness, which can be present on examination. When we send the labs, what we find is leukopenia, WBC on the lower side, and eosinopenia. In the differential count, we get to see the eosinophils, basophils, monocytes, lymphocytes. In such patients, in the initial week, eosinopenia is a prominent feature. Absolutely zero eosinophil count, which will be seen. So that is a non-specific sign which points more towards typhoid. So in the simple hemogram, we can always look for this when we are suspecting typhoid fever. There will be transaminitis as it occurs in all kinds of infection. Now when a patient comes to us with typhoid, diagnostic is blood culture. If the blood culture shows a salmonella, 110% it is typhoid. But blood culture will take 2 to 3 days to come, isn't it? It takes time for the organism to grow. So we have many tests that are available on the OPD basis. TyfeFast IgM and Typhi.dot IgM. Again, they are serological tests. We want to see the IgM antibody. So it will come positive later in the disease. Then we can give significance to that. If it is positive in the first week, it could be non-specific. It could be false positive. So it is sensitive. 100% sensitivity is there, but it is not that specific. Vidal test, which we commonly do on the OPD basis, but guidelines say that it is not sensitive and it is not specific. So if we have just one report in front of us of Vidal positive, that should not be considered as a diagnosis of typhoid fever. What is considered is the serial measurements of Vidal in 1 week, in the second week, in the third week. And if there is a fourfold rise in the titers, then it will be considered as diagnostic. So we always have to consider the serial measurements, not just one report of Vidal. Treatment, tablet azithromycin. Usually patients with enteric fever come to us saying that they have received antibiotics on the OPD basis, you know, with any physician when they come. The reason behind this, and there's no response, the fever is persistent, there is very high grade fever. There is a reason behind this is we need to treat enteric fever with a high dose of ceftriaxone or azithromycin. So usually patients may have received a first generation cephalosporin, a second generation cephalosporin, or even a third generation. Let's say the patient has received cefixime also. But what do we give for, what is the dose of cefixime which we give on the OPD basis? It is just 200 mg BD. But in enteric fever, what is the dose of cefixime? It is double the dose, higher the dose, 400 mg BD. So there is going to be no response to the simple antibiotics which we give on the OPD basis for patients of enteric fever. So usually when the patient complains of high grade fever, even after taking antibiotics, this fever is persistent, we can definitely think of typhoid fever. And usually the fever is prolonged. 1 week ho gaya, 2 weeks ho gaya, still I'm having fever and there is no response to the changing of antibiotics also. First we give a first generation cephalosporin, then we have gone to a second generation cephalosporin thinking of some other infection which the patient has and there is no response. That time definitely suspect enteric fever in such cases. Treatment on OPD basis is tablet azithromycin, 1 gram OD for 5 days. Some guidelines say 1 gram OD loading dose as in on day 1 and followed by 500 mg for 6 days. If the patient gets admitted, ceftriaxone is to be given. That will also be a higher dose, 3 grams which is usually given, followed by cefixime. And the duration should be 14 days for enteric fever when the patient is admitted, IPD patients. So that was about the tropical illnesses. Now a little bit about gastroenteritis. These also patients come commonly to us, patients of diarrhea. So whenever a patient comes to us of diarrhea, the first thing which we want to find out is the etiology, whether it is viral, whether it is bacterial, because the treatment completely is different for a viral etiology and a bacterial etiology. So the fever in viral etiology, it will be very uncommon. It may be present, but in less number of patients. So if the patient just complains of loose motions and there's no fever, think of a viral etiology. It does not require any antibiotics at all. Even though he may be having 20 loose motions per day, 30 loose motions per day, if he's not febrile, it could be a viral etiology. He doesn't require any antibiotics at all. While fever with loose motions, think of a bacterial cause, think of a bacterial etiology and he may require antibiotics. Vomiting, prominent feature in viral etiology, while not so prominent in bacterial. One thing that we want to ask is if the patient is suffering from dysentery. Dysentery means blood in the stools, blood in the loose motions. So if that is present, it will go towards a bacterial etiology and we need to be very careful regarding such patients. So if it is a non-bloody diarrhea, it points towards a viral etiology. If it's a bloody diarrhea or dysentery, it points towards a bacterial etiology. Diagnosis viral, even if we do the stool routine examination, it will be absolutely normal. Viruses are not seen under the microscope. So it is just a diagnosis of exclusion. While if we are suspecting dysentery, if we are suspecting a bacterial etiology for the diarrhea, this is besides the simple laboratory investigations, the CBC, LFT, RFT, the electrolytes which we do. Also the important thing is the stool routine examination. Now in the stool routine examination, what exactly do we have to see? Okay, we want to see for the fecal leukocytes, the WBCs, the pus cells, stool pus cells, how many are present. If they are present, it points towards a bacterial etiology. We want to see whether any occult blood is present. Occult blood, blood in the stools means it becomes a case of dysentery, it becomes a case of bacterial diarrhea. Okay, so the two things that we want to see is the occult blood, whether it is positive or not, and the fecal leukocytes or the pus cells, whether they are present or not. And also the cyst or the trophozytes or the ova, if they are present or not, which tells us about a parasitic etiology, whether it is cryptosporidia, whether it is trophozytes of giardia, whether it is amoeba, amoebiasis, if the patient has. The treatment will be different for parasitic diarrhea. but commonly it is either viral or bacterial etiology. So treatment viral, it will be supportive, and antibiotics will be required for a bacterial etiology. Now in bacterial etiology also, there are two types. In short, we need to remember, one is a non-inflammatory diarrhea and another is the inflammatory diarrhea. Non-inflammatory is also called a secretory diarrhea, and the inflammatory becomes the invasive diarrhea. So the non-inflammatory diarrhea affects the small intestine, while the inflammatory, dysentery, invasive diarrhea affects the large intestine. Here, bacterial etiology also, but there may be non-bloody diarrhea. Okay, while invasive diarrhea, there will be a bloody diarrhea which is present. Non-inflammatory, usually it has a short incubation period. The patient may have consumed some outside food and within 6 to 8 hours he is presented to us with diarrhea. While it may be a longer incubation period, up to 24 to 48 hours or maybe longer in cases of dysentery. No fecal leukocytes. When we do the stool routine examination, although we are suspecting a bacterial cause, there may be fever suspecting a bacterial cause, but still there are no fecal leukocytes in such patients. Then the patient does not require antibiotics, even though it is a bacterial cause for the fever. So the stool routine examination becomes absolutely important in patients of diarrhea. While if it is invasive diarrhea, there will be fecal leukocytes, there will be fecal pus cells which are present. So if we see that, we have to treat the patient with antibiotics. So causes, which are the bacteria causing non-inflammatory diarrhea? It is cholera, V. cholera, Vibrio cholera. It is Bacillus cereus, it is Staphylococcus aureus. While the ones causing invasive diarrhea are E. coli, Shigella, Salmonella, Campylobacter jejuni, etc. This non-inflammatory diarrhea is enterotoxin mediated. Okay, what it means is that the Staphylococcus aureus, Bacillus cereus, okay, usually the patient gives history of some Chinese food that the patient has had in a hotel, fried rice, then we need to suspect preformed toxins, that is this Bacillus cereus or Staphylococcus aureus. The reason being that usually in unhygienic locations, in hotels and street side vendors, what they do is the stale food, they just reheat it and serve it to all of us. So when the heating takes place, definitely the bacteria are killed. The Staphylococcus aureus will die, the Bacillus cereus also will die. But whatever toxins they have already produced will remain like that only. They are very heat stable. They won't be affected by the heating, reheating, boiling, nothing. They will be very much heat stable. And those are the ones, the toxins are the ones which cause the diarrhea. It is not the bacteria, but the toxins already formed by them which is causing the diarrhea. So that comes under non-inflammatory diarrhea. That is why it is in the stool routine also you won't find any fecal leukocytes because it is just the toxins causing the diarrhea. While in invasive diarrhea, what happens is, whenever we ingest any contaminated food, the bacteria will go in the colon and they will invade, they will destroy the intestinal cells. Once they destroy, once the integrity is lost, blood will come in the diarrhea, that becomes dysentery, and they secrete toxins over there. The bacteria, they invade the intestine and secrete toxins, and that will cause the inflammatory mediators, the cytokines will be released and all the other factors released, and that is why we get dysentery and the fecal leukocytes on the examination. So acute diarrhea usually less than 2 weeks duration. If it is more than 2 weeks, if it is more than 4 weeks, it becomes chronic diarrhea and the etiology completely differs. The treatment completely differs of chronic diarrhea. That is a different entity. So most commonly what we see is the acute diarrhea duration less than 2 weeks. Most of the cases are self-resolving, self-limiting. We don't have to do anything for such patients. Just give them oral rehydration and the patient will be absolutely fine in 2 days. If he doesn't improve in 2 days, if the patient has persistent fever, if the patient keeps having loose motions after 48 hours also, after 2 days also, then we need to investigate such patients. Okay, otherwise there is no requirement of any lab tests also, no requirement of any stool routine also to be sent. Wait for 48 hours, wait for 2 days. If there is no improvement, then think of doing lab investigations and treating the patient. So the history taking becomes very much important. What the patient has consumed, like I said, Chinese food, think of Bacillus cereus. If he's had any packaged food, canned food, outside street side vendors, think of Staphylococcus aureus, think of Salmonella, contaminated water especially, think of Salmonella. assess for dehydration after taking the history. Whenever a patient comes to us with diarrhea, I think all of us know that we need to assess for the signs of dehydration, whether it is mildly dehydrated or severely dehydrated. A few points will be: see if the patient is thirsty, see if the patient is alert, that means he's just mildly dehydrated. If the patient is comatose, if he's lethargic, it will be severe dehydration. Simple, see the radial pulse. If it is of good volume, the patient is just mildly dehydrated. If it is feeble, if you cannot feel the pulse, the patient is severely dehydrated. Simple thing. Another is see the blood pressure. If it is normal, nothing to worry about. If the systolic blood pressure is less than 80, if it is not recordable, we need to worry about such patients. Another thing is ask the patient about the urine output along with the diarrhea, whether he's passing urine well. If he says yes, absolutely no problem, we can wait. Treat the patient conservatively. If he says there is reduced urine output, we need to keep a close watch on these patients. Another important thing is the skin elasticity, which we see. Okay, this is how we do it on the abdomen. If the skin retraction is more than 2 seconds, we need to be careful regarding such patients. If it is less than 2 seconds, if the skin goes back within 2 seconds, the patient might be just mildly dehydrated. He just needs ORS solutions and he can be sent home. So labs, if the patient is not improving in 2 days, if he continues to have loose motions and fever, the basic labs we can do, we can see the hemogram, see for leukocytosis, do the RFT, see the creatinine, see the electrolytes, because that is getting lost in the loose motions. Sodium, potassium is getting lost. So if that is electrolyte imbalance is there, we need to treat that. Stool routine examination, like I already told you. Treatment becomes ORS solution, the sachet which we get. How much can he take? How much can he consume? Around 2 to 4 liters per day, along with any additional water which he wants. Now suppose if a patient is very poor, he cannot go to the medical store and buy ORS. Let's say the patient is alone at home. There is no relative who can go and get the ORS solution to him. What do we advise him? Home-based therapy of oral rehydration. Just ask him to take 1 liter of clean water, 1 teaspoon of salt and 6 tablespoons of sugar. That is all is required. Tell him to start with this ORS, simple rehydration solution. Then when he can go and buy a ORS packet from the medical store, that will be absolutely helpful. Another thing is let him continue with water. But the fruit beverages, the fruit juices which are present, they should not be consumed because they contain only glucose. What we require is the electrolytes also, sodium and potassium. Okay, which will be present in salt, water along with sugar. So in just fruit juices, the sweetened, the packaged ones which we have, that contains only glucose, which is not enough. Plus, he can continue to take the other normal diet also. Now, in different fields, we come from different fields, so this may differ whether he needs to continue taking his normal diet or not. But in our field, what is recommended is let him continue with the normal diet, whatever he's taking, along with the oral rehydration. There is no food restriction for such patients. Restriction will be in the form of not consuming any unhygienic food. That's it. Always homemade, fresh, cooked food he can have. If the patient is severely dehydrated, admit the patient. What is required is Ringer's lactate. If that is also not available, we can give simple NS also. Now, which patients to give antibiotics? Like I said, most of them are self-resolving. Wait for 2 days. If there is no improvement, then definitely we need to give them antibiotics. A simple plain ciprofloxacin is recommended. 500 mg BD for 5 days. It will cover all the invasive bacteria causing diarrhea. It will cover E. coli, it will cover Shigella, it will cover Campylobacter jejuni also. So a simple antibiotic course, Ciprox, 500 mg BD for 5 days. If the patient says, I'm having rice watery stools, classic rice watery stools, severely dehydrated, maybe a lot of patients coming to us with the same complaints, and if we are suspecting cholera, we have sent a stool for hanging drop, only a single dose of doxycycline is all that is required, 300 mg, one dose only, along with the rehydration, the oral rehydration, that will be there for cholera. So this is just a case, a young male college-going student who has a lot of outside food from the street-side vendors. He's come to us with loose motions. He's saying, I'm having a lot of loose motions 15 to 20 times for the past 1 day since yesterday. On examination, there's no fever, there's no blood in the stools. On examination, we saw that the patient is pretty dehydrated, mildly dehydrated. He's having tachycardia, pulse is on the higher side, BP slightly on the lower side, 90 by 60. He's having a dry tongue, but the skin elasticity is also more than 2 seconds. Do we need to send lab tests in such a patient who's a young patient who's just mildly or maybe moderately dehydrated? Is there a need to send laboratory investigations? So we can wait for such a patient. Like I said, what is the first treatment? Oral rehydration. Even though the patient is mildly dehydrated, even though the patient is moderately dehydrated, what we need to do is just give the patient ORS solution. Wait for 2 days. If he doesn't improve, yes, we have to give antibiotics. If he doesn't improve, yes, we have to advise admission to such a patient. And we will investigate the patient with the normal CBC, LFT, RFT, the electrolytes. Along with that, we will be doing a stool routine examination. And how should we treat? So I said, the first time when he comes to us, ORS solution only. Ask him to come back to us daily, if not after 2 days. See the patient again on follow-up. If there's no improvement, then we have to investigate, then we have to treat. If there is an improvement, there is no requirement of any antibiotic. And what antibiotics to give if the patient has not improved after 2 days? Simple ciprofloxacin, 500 mg, twice a day for 5 days. And if the patient says rice watery stools on the first day itself when he comes to us, we need to give just one dose of doxycycline, 300 mg. That is a higher dose, not the usual 100 mg. It is 300 mg for cholera. So similarly, that was one young patient, college-going student who came to us. Let's say another patient comes who is a 60 years old, elderly female. She is diabetic. She is saying that she's having dysentery 10 times for the past 2 days, and there is a lot of abdominal cramps, there is a lot of abdominal tenderness. Dysentery is blood in the stools. She is febrile on examination. She is having a lot of fever. Pulse is 98, BP is also okay, 100 by 70, and she is having a dry tongue. Baki, the rest of the parameters are absolutely fine. So the dehydration category will be mild dehydration for this patient. But she is complaining of dysentery, blood in the stools, and having a fever. So it becomes essential to do the lab tests in her. So the usual one, CBC, LFT, RFT, electrolytes. Along with that, what we need to do is the stool routine examination to see for the pus cells, to see for the occult blood which is present. Should we treat her on day one itself? Yes. Because she is having dysentery, because she is having fever, because she is having blood in the stools. So what antibiotic to give? Again, the same ciprofloxacin, simple plain ciprofloxacin, 500 mg BD for 5 days will be sufficient. Is there a need for antibiotic in this patient? Yes, it is essential. Similarly, was it important in the youngster, you know, who came, a college-going student having history of outside food consumption with a lot of loose motions? No, there was no requirement in him. But in this lady, it will be important. So hepatitis, a 40 years old male who comes to us with fever, vomiting, a reduced urine output, reduced appetite, and a yellow urine or maybe some yellow discoloration of the eyes also for the past 5 days. He's icteric, he's got a nice hepatomegaly. The labs to send besides the basic ones of LFT will be HBsAg, anti-HCV, hepatitis A when we are suspecting viral hepatitis, hepatitis AIgM, and hepatitis EIgM. Treatment, even though it is viral hepatitis, it will be absolutely supportive. No antibiotics, just fluids and the other supportive treatment. Paracetamol for the fever, etc. Even though the patient is HBsAg positive and he is having icterus and jaundice right now, in the acute phase, treatment is supportive. Later on, yes, we do the viral load, we treat the patient with antivirals. But in the first stage, when he comes to us with jaundice, acute hepatitis B, treatment is supportive. Similarly, for hepatitis C, when it is acute hepatitis C, treatment is supportive. Later on, yes, in him also, we will be advising the titers, the levels of the hepatitis C virus, and then treat him. But in the acute stage, it will be supportive treatment only. Urinary tract infection, ABU. There is a concept called as asymptomatic bacteriuria. Many patients might be coming to y'all for physical fitness certificates. And when we do the lab investigations, the urine routine might be showing pus cells, 20 to 30, 30 to 40 pus cells. But the patient is absolutely normal. There is no fever, there is no burning micturition, there is no abdominal pain. Then do we need to treat the lab report? No. this will come under asymptomatic bacteriuria. Asymptomatic, patient is absolutely without any symptoms. Bacteriuria, there will be pustules, there will be bacteria in the urine. But please treat the patient, don't treat the lab report. That is what I will say. If the patient is asymptomatic, do not give any antibiotics for the pus cells in the urine. If the patient has a lot of comorbidities, he's a diabetic, he's an elderly, be careful about these patients when they come to us with UTI. He's got a history of renal calculi surgeries, he's got a DJ stent in situ, he's undergone PCNL. Be very careful because these patients may have MDR pathogens which will not be responding to the simple antibiotics which we give on OPD basis. They might require admission. Patients who is catheterized, who's got a Foley's, again that is a foreign body inside the body, and it will lead to recurrent UTI infections. On examination, an important point which we need to see is for the renal angle tenderness on the back, the left costal margin below that and next to the erector spinae muscles. We see for tenderness at this side because that is where the kidney is palpated. If the tenderness is present, that means the kidneys are involved. The infection has gone up, it has ascended up to the kidneys. So this becomes acute pyelonephritis and such patients need to be admitted. If there is flank pain, if there is fever, if there is burning micturition. So this point is important. In the laboratories, besides the normal ones which we do, what we have to do is the USG pelvis. We want to see for the kidney involvement, we want to see for pyelonephritis, we want to see the bladder involvement, which is usually cystitis, we want to see the trabeculated bladder wall which is present, and the urine routine which will show the pus cells and the leukocyte esterase present. So such patients, so UTI can be either uncomplicated or complicated. Again, the treatment is different. What do you mean by uncomplicated? A young female, 30 years old female who's non-diabetic, doesn't have any comorbid conditions. She comes with fever, burning micturition, on examination. She might be having febrile, she might be having a fever, lower abdominal pain, but there is no renal angle tenderness. That just tells me that it is a lower urinary tract infection. It is not involved up to the kidneys. So do I need to send lab test? May not be essential. We may send it, but when it is uncomplicated, we can just treat the patient with nitrofurantoin, 100 mg BD for 5 days. Now if the same patient had a renal angle tenderness, if the kidneys were involved, nitrofurantoin will not be effective. Nitrofurantoin, it will be effective only in the lower urinary tract, up to the bladder. If the infection is beyond the bladder, cannot treat with nitrofurantoin. And it is a very good drug. It has very good levels in the urinary bladder, in the urine. And it will treat most of the organisms, the most common ones, E. coli, it will treat. Nitrofurantoin will treat. Similarly, if it's a 68 years old elderly female who's diabetic, HbA1c of 9 and 10, uncontrolled diabetes, and she comes with fever, a left flank pain, burning micturition and a decreased urine output, and there is renal angle tenderness on examination, then the labs, yes, we have to send the CBC, RFT, USG pelvis, urine routine, and also one more investigation comes over here, which is the urine culture, which will tell us what is the organisms and help us to guide the antibiotic if the patient is not responding in the initial antibiotic treatment. And treatment for such patients will be admission and injection, piperacillin, tazobactam, and even meropenem, carbapenems may be required, because many diabetic patients having E. coli, they are multi-drug resistant, producing ESBLs, okay, or they could be pan-drug resistant also, especially those patients having pyelonephritis. Absolutely essential to be careful regarding such patients. They can suddenly worsen, basically. So little bit about the respiratory tract infections. One important thing, many patients come to us with common cold, simple rhinitis, simple pharyngitis, a sore throat, fever. Do we actually need to treat these patients with antibiotics? Of course, it is very difficult on the clinical grounds to differentiate whether it is viral or bacterial. But there could be a few points which will point towards a viral etiology, and these patients will not require any antibiotic at all. So important thing to remember is most of them are caused by viruses. Most of the upper respiratory tract infections are caused by viruses. So it is only in a small proportion of patients only that you need to give antibiotics. Only 25% patients have a bacterial etiology, while the others will have a viral etiology who do not need any antibiotic at all. So on examination with a simple tongue depressor, which is there in our OPD, what we can see is the pharyngeal and the tonsillar exudates. You can see over here the white discharge which is present. Yes, you can see the small pus pocket over here. So that just tells us that it could very well be a bacterial etiology and the patient definitely needs antibiotics. Many patients just have tonsillar hypertrophy, they might have pharyngeal tonsillar congestion, the redness which is present. They do not require antibiotics. It could point towards a viral etiology also. So the treatment, if we have to treat on the OPD basis for acute rhinopharyngitis, treatment is amoxicillin clavulanate acid, 625 mg TDS for 5 days. And if we are giving a 1 gram dose, that will be BD. Okay, it is not a BD, 625 BD is not the dose, it is 625 mg TDS for 5 days which is given. So a little bit about antibiotic resistance. When antibiotics are used for incorrect indication, for an incorrect dosage, incorrect duration, it will give rise to antibiotic resistance, which we are seeing very commonly in our patients. So one thing to remember is when we give a simple viral acute rhinopharyngitis case with no pharyngeal exudates and we treat the patient suspecting a bacterial etiology, we give him amoxicillin clavulanic acid. Now important thing is remember is there are normal gut flora which is present. So E. coli, Escherichia coli is also normally present in our gut. That will be exposed to this amoxclav. Today when we are treating a patient of acute rhinopharyngitis with amoxclav, the gut flora are also exposed, and when they are exposed, they will gradually get the antibiotic resistance to them. Of course, today they won't cause any infection, but later on when the immunity reduces, when the patient becomes diabetic, his sugars are uncontrolled and his immunity is depressed, that time this E. coli will come up. This E. coli, which has already been exposed to amoxclav, will come up, and that time there will be a difficulty to treat the patient with amoxclav. It will be resistant. So such patients will require carbapenems. Okay, a higher antibiotic, piperacillin tazobactam. If the amoxclav is resistant, it may be sensitive to piptaz. We'll have to admit the patient and give him either piptaz or carbapenems. So this is a plasmid mediated resistance between bacteria. So here you can see the plasmids which are present next to the bacterial DNA. So they just take a few parts of this bacterial DNA. Let's say this bacteria has been exposed to an antibiotic and it has developed some genes which are resistant to that antibiotic. So the plasmid is going to carry this resistant antibiotic mechanism, and this plasmid will go to some other bacteria and give this information of the bacterial antibiotic resistance to the other bacteria also. So that is how basically how antibiotic resistance occurs. So we have got MDR pathogens, which are the multi-drug pathogens, Klebsiella, Acinetobacter baumannii, they could be MDR, just susceptible to carbapenems or colistin. We have even some pathogens who are pan-drug resistant, PDR. Even your meropenem, carbapenem, they are not susceptible. Even colistin, they are resistant to that. So there is absolutely no antibiotic left to treat such bugs, the PDR pathogens. There is no new antibiotic in the market which is available. At the most, what we can go is up to the carbapenems. At the most, for gram-negative, what we can go is up to colistin. If these bugs are resistant to these two antibiotic classes also, there is no antibiotic left to treat such patients with. So we need to be careful about what antibiotics are given. We need to conserve the available antibiotics. Of course, we need to give it to the patients, but give it for the proper indication, give it for the proper dosage and the proper duration also. Special population, immunocompromised, need to be extra careful about these patients. HIV positive, because the etiology will completely differ. Fungal infections may be common. The parasitic infections may be common in HIV positive patients. Transplant recipients, those who are on steroids, glucocorticoids for a long time, we need to be careful. Diabetic patients who have uncontrolled sugars need to be careful regarding such patients. Chronic kidney failure, who are on dialysis, who come to the hospital for dialysis and go back. When they come to the hospital, they get exposed to these MDR pathogens of the other patients. So we need to be careful when they come to us on the OPD basis for treatment. We need to suspect these MDR pathogens in them. Previous hospitalization, again important. One patient gets admitted in the hospital, there are n number of patients around. With simple hand from the nurses, from the hand contamination also, one patient can have one infection and it can just spread to the other patients also, nearby patients. So it becomes important if the patient has been previously hospitalized in the past 3 months. Previous surgeries also become important. Like I said, DJ stenting becomes important for UTI. And one last point is the geriatric population, elderly patients which come to us above 60, above 70 years old. They have a lot of comorbid conditions. They may be on some antihypertensive. They may be diabetic, which may be uncontrolled. Again, they may be having multiple medications also, which can have drug interaction with the antibiotics, with whatever medicines we give them. They can have interactions with that and land up with some other side effects. They can have symptoms different from organ involved. Many times an elderly patient, I had one patient who came with a confused state for the past 1 day. He did not have any fever. He did not have any localizing symptom. When I examined him, he had nice bronchial breathing on the right side. So it was a case of pneumonia. But what was the symptom that he came with? He came with a confused state for the past 1 day. Elderly Azoba, 80 years old Azoba who came. So such geriatric population, they may have symptoms, some other symptom, and the organ involvement may be some other. So need to be careful about such patients. And they may also not mount a fever response. They already may be immunosuppressed and they may not come with a fever. Although they are suffering from pneumonia, although they are suffering from a urinary tract infection, still they may not have a fever response. So the geriatric population, we need to be careful. So the take home message is fluoroquine alone, do not use it for respiratory tract infection, because we want to conserve these antibiotics for MDR-TB. Now, moxifloxacin, levofloxacin, that is given for MDR-TB. Spare amoxiclav for acute rhinopharyngitis, for common cold. If you have to give, if you're suspecting a bacterial etiology, give it in the right dose at the correct duration. Spare the third generation cephalosporins. I'm not saying that there is absolutely no need to give antibiotics. I'm not saying that. Yes, in some cases you have to give antibiotics. But go for the simple ones. Go for the first generation antibiotics. Go for a second generation antibiotics. When you give a third generation cephalosporin, just think twice before giving it. Use the correct antibiotic in the correct dose for the correct time, which will help us to prevent antibiotic resistance in the future.